We usually close the night with this, but we're not going to close. We're going to do a couple more after this. Oh, that would have been a great place to start. When you do that, I'm going to play the mode. Bring it down, vamp for a second. Guys, we're going to go back to bar 205 because the audience failed to do their part, which it should be pretty obvious at this point that you should be singing along. So I'm going to sing my little line, and then you follow the guys over here. Got it? We're going to try that again. Right at bar 205, all right? Here we go.
Oh, when you're smiling, when you're smiling, the whole world smiles with you. When you're laughing, yes, when you're laughing, the sun comes shining through. Oh, when you're crying, it brings on the rain. Stop your crying, be happy again. Oh, when you're smiling, I can't live long enough to love you. Life isn't long enough, baby, but I'm gonna love you as long as I live. What if I can't buy you diamonds and rings like I want to? Life isn't long enough, baby, but I can love you as long as I live. I never cared, but now I'm scared. I won't live long enough. So I grab my umbrella when it rains and eat an apple every day, but see the doctor anyway. What if I can't live to love you as long as I want to? Life isn't long enough, baby, but I can love you as long as I live. Oh, yeah. Thank you. can't live to love you as long as I want to. Life isn't long enough, baby, but I can love you as long as I live. What if I can't buy you diamonds and bling like I want to? I can promise you, baby, I'm gonna want to as long as I live. See, I never cared, but now I'm scared I won't live long enough. So I grab an umbrella when it rains and I eat an apple every day, but see the doctor anyway. What if I can't live to love you as long as I want to? Life isn't long enough, baby, but I can promise you that I'm gonna love you as long as I live.
I believe we are the only band in the world that performs this song. True. We give you the theme to ABC's Celebrity Bowling by request. Johnson.
Thank you.
ABC Celebrity Bowling.
Thank you.
I'm Christopher Burkhardt with Stellar Shows and Concerts, and we appreciate you and all the support you've given our series of Eclectic American Roots programs over the past 12 presentations. We create all these shows with a musician in mind. The generous proceeds that you donate are the only revenues we have to pass on to our out-of-work musician friends. Today our show revolves around the jazz trumpet with a special tribute to Satchmo, also known as Louis Armstrong. We have a who's who of jazz trumpeteers on today's show and a pair of hosts who are experts on the genre, Tony Guerrero and Terence Love. We are taking the liberty of combining this episode with our sister show, which is also produced by JAX Entertainment, the popular jazz series named Steamer's Jazz at JAX. Also, our video host, Big Sandy, contributes a power pack of vintage videos from the likes of Dizzy Gillespie, Cat Anderson, and Miles Davis. Now, the trumpet has been around for 4,000 years, and it reached its heyday after valves were introduced, making it more than a one-note wonder. In the 19th century, the cornet was created with its smaller scale and mellower sound. It was perfect for the jazz being developed in New Orleans by the blacks, the whites, and the mixed-race Creoles, and Buddy Bolden was its main innovator. Bolden played a more dirty ragtime style with syncopation, and he embellished it for street parades. Bolden also brought it into the dance halls. He loosened up the ragtime beat and improvised more than others ever had before. The more professional Creole musicians already in the dance halls started swinging the beat and playing a freer style as a result of hearing Bolden, and also to better compete with his success. This may well have been the genesis of the blending of European music with African music in the beginning of jazz. Early players influenced by Buddy Bolden include Joe King Oliver, Freddie Capard, and Bunk Johnson. Let's kick today's jazz show off with a clip by that same King Oliver and his cornet on Speakeasy Blues.
I've been collecting Louis Armstrong stuff since, well, it's been about 30 years now. From autographs to unpublished photos, concert programs, and even a personal item of his, and some of this stuff dates back to 1927. I was given a painting back in 1992 by an artist who, unfortunately, I've lost touch with, but he gave me this beautiful oil painting of Louis Armstrong. Once somebody saw that hanging in my house, my manager at the time, Lucille, she gave me this statue that had been in her father's bar in New York, and it wasn't far from where Louis Armstrong lived, so I always thought it'd be cool to think that he actually walked into that bar and saw this at one point. And in fact, he had the very same statue on his piano in his home in Corona, Queens. Ooh, Corona. I'm going to start with one of my favorite items, although it's not much to look at the way I have it displayed. Inside that envelope is one of Louis Armstrong's personal handkerchiefs that he used in concert, I believe in the 1950s, in Europe. Now, I keep it in that envelope because he signed this handkerchief and the signature is fading from all the light, so I keep it hidden. But let me show it to you now. If you look close to the top, you can just see the faintest hint of his signature where he signed it. Unfortunately, that ink will probably disappear over time, but at least I'll know it was there at one time.
And hello, everybody, your video host, Big Sandy, back with another Buzzin' Dozen video clips, as today we explore jazz trumpet. I have some really entertaining clips lined up for the day, but if you learn something along the way, hey, all the better. Things won't be laid out chronologically, but rather I'll be sort of riffing here and there, riffing in a jazz-like sort of fashion, I guess you might say. Okay, let's get to it. New Orleans, Henry Red Allen. Now this cat, he was a few years younger than Louis Armstrong and followed in his wake stylistically. He was one of the first to fully incorporate all the innovations that Armstrong was laying down. Well, let's just watch him right now from a 1957 broadcast featuring Coleman Hawkins and Pee Wee Russell. Here he is, Henry Red Allen. ¶¶
llama, noodle llama,
noodle
the umbrellas and the umbrellas.
Don't make it too late.
Bring your parasol, it may be small, it may be big. Teeny pass them all with what you call the thingamajig. The batter, 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 batter,
it looks like rain.
He'll mend your umbrellas and then go on the way. Singing to the little llama to the lake, a little llama to the lake, and the umbrella to the lake today.
The old school meets the new as the great Dizzy Gillespie goes toe-to-toe with today's featured artist, Louis Armstrong. Now, Dizzy later wrote about the importance of that meeting. He spoke of it as being like a symbolic olive branch between the old school trad jazzers and the beboppers of his day. So an important moment captured on film there. Hope you dug that. Now, let's focus on two jazz women, starting off with a pre-Armstrong trumpeter. She started playing as a child, and then over the years went on to record with Ma Rainey and worked with Josephine Baker. And arguably, she's the first woman to cut a jazz record. But we're not going to argue about that right now. Let's just watch Dolly Jones.
Thank you. Jurassic will win a beauty test with patience 42. Dick Tracy will get a rest, have patience 42. Pullman trains will soon have faith, have patience 42. Crosby's horse will win a race, have patience 42.
No danger.
Patience and 42. Patience and 42.
I love that. The latest Snow in the Alibaba Trio from 1936, Patience and Fortitude. Now, Valeda was another one who started performing at a very early age, working with her family, became a dancer and an actress, and toured the world. She toured throughout Europe and in the Far East until 1941. She was arrested and captured by the Nazis. She was held as a prisoner until eventually she was released, some sort of a prisoner exchange deal. And at that point, she came back to the United States, continued to perform till 1956, when she sadly collapsed on stage and died of a brain hemorrhage. So, a jazz pioneer, Valeda Snow. I'll be back shortly.
Our eclectic American roots show today is called Satchmo and Beyond, the Roots of Jazz Trumpet. And we have a very distinguished pair of hosts for you. Terence Love is the former proprietor of Steamer's Jazz Club in Fullerton, California. After 22 years of presenting the best in jazz, he has recently become the executive producer of Steamer's Jazz at JAX, a regular streaming show that continues his penchant for bringing in top talent and exposing new talent as well. If a jazz club married a cocktail party, Terence would be its love child. Co-host Tony Guerrero is the perfect partner for Terence with his aptitude for playing jazz trumpet himself. Tony is a contemporary jazz flugelhornist, trumpeter, composer, and producer who has earned both critical success and a worldwide audience. Tony has released 12 solo CDs, some charting on the Billboard Top 20. He has appeared in over 200 albums as either producer, composer, arranger, or musician, and performs on trumpet, flugelhorn, piano, guitar, and more. Tony's work as a musician and composer can also be heard in movies and on television. Please welcome to our show, Tony Guerrero and Terence Love.
Hey, everybody.
Hey, everybody. How you doing, Tony? Hey, and thank you so much, Christopher. You know, Steamer's Jazz at Campus JAX, you know, we're excited to team up with you as our sister production arm here at JAX Entertainment for this special, you know, Satchmo and Beyond, the Trumpets of Jazz. We've got Randy Brecker, Rick Braun, Arturo Sandoval, Ricky Riccardi.
And Terence, I don't know if you know this, but I actually play trumpet.
So, yeah. Oh, I didn't mention you.
So for me, a gathering like this is it's pretty heady stuff, because those are some of the great, you know, I'll just go down the list. You know, Rick Braun has been a force on the horn for the last 20 or so years and really kind of led the whole smooth jazz market. Randy Brecker, of course, has been around since really the late 60s, but all through the 70s with the Brecker brothers,
right.
And just one of the premier players. And of course, Arturo Sandoval, one of the greatest players who ever picked up the instrument. And it's just a thrill to have all three of them. And then the name Ricky Riccardi. Ricky's not actually a trumpet player, but he is the curator or the director of the Louis Armstrong archives and the House Museum in Corona, Queens. And I've been able to visit him in New York a couple of times. And actually, he let me play on Louis Armstrong's horns. And there's all sorts of great stuff that he's just full of so much knowledge about Louis Armstrong. And so he's going to be here. And I'm going to share some of my Louis Armstrong collection as well. So I'm excited about all that. And you ready, Terence?
I was going to say, you know, do you don't mind if, you don't mind if I quote you on that bit about being a trumpet player? That's okay for the future, then, right?
It's okay. Yeah, yeah. I may not be able to back it up.
Great.
But yeah, you can.
No. We had a blast with all those guys, and I'll tell you, especially Randy, you know, because I was a big Blood, Sweat, and Tears fan, and you know, he was there. I was here before trumpets, you know,
right. When it was just a conch shell. Right. What do they call it? The shofar. All right, so listen, we're gonna get right into it. So pucker up your lips, and we're gonna get right into it with some Randy Brecker right here, and we'll see you soon.
Six-time Grammy Award-winning jazz trumpeter and composer, Randy Brecker has helped shape the sound of jazz, R&B, and rock for more than four decades. His trumpet and flugelhorn performances have graced hundreds of albums by a wide range of artists, from James Taylor, Bruce Springsteen, Parliament Funkadelic, to Frank Sinatra, Steely Dan, Jaco Pastorius, Frank Zappa, and also with the Grammy Award-winning Brecker Brothers. As a composer, performer, and in-demand Yamaha clinician, Randy Brecker continues to influence and inspire young musicians around the world. Randy will be joined by his wife, Italian native Ada Ravatti, on saxophone. Ada has performed with musical greats Mike Stern, John McLaughlin, Bob Minzer, James Moody, Aretha Franklin, Herbie Hancock, Jimmy Heath, and Patti Austin, and was part of the Grammy Award-winning CD by Randy Brecker, 34th and Lex.
Randy, Ada, and Stella Brecker, COVID Blues. Here we go. One, two, one, two, eight.
Yes. Well, welcome.
Oh, thank you. Yeah. Enjoying this.
Yeah. Ladies and gentlemen, this is Randy Brecker and Otto Ravatti and their daughter, Stella. And
Stella!
We're cool to have them with us. And certainly for me, being somebody who also owns a trumpet, it's a real honor to have you.
Oh, come on, man.
Sounds great. You know, obviously, I'm a big fan for so many years. And
well, thank you.
Thrilled to be able to have you on here. And you're in
we're in East Hampton, Long Island.
Hampton.
Oh,
yeah,
okay.
On a tip.
Yeah.
So you want to tell us a little bit about what we just saw in the video there, you know?
Well, you saw our little trio. We did that a couple weeks ago, and that was the first. Nobody's seen that before. So on our phone, we jammed up a little COVID blues.
Nice.
And it was a lot of fun. I think that was the first time we actually played together as a trio. Hopefully not the last.
Now, Stella, just so you know, you're supposed to get paid for that. So I don't know if, yeah. I don't know if they told you or not.
That's right.
Well, that was great. Glad to get to the premiere again.
You know, luckily we have music in our lives, so we're still practicing and futzing around with tunes and thinking about future projects, et cetera, et cetera. So that still takes up time. And we have everything at our fingertips, I'm happy to say. I'm just kind of studying a lot of different musical things. So we're still trying to stay busy. You know, as a trumpet player, can't let up with that. Mm. At home, and my good friend, Russian trumpet player, Alex Sipiagin, was doing it in the midst of a Zoom thing with Mike Rodriguez, another great trumpet player. And lo and behold, the amazing classical trumpet player, Sergei Nakariakov.
Yeah. Yeah.
I knew, we met 20 years ago in Japan. He came up and played his some pieces with the Dizzy Gillespie Big Band, but it was pretty, I had no idea who was gonna be there. So I was really kind of taken aback. This was just yesterday. So yeah. It's amazing, the communication thing. He was in Paris, Alex is out here, and Mike was in Queens. Yeah. We had a great trumpet discussion for about an hour.
Yeah, it is. I will say that this time has allowed us, one, a lot of us are just trying to think of out of the box ways to stay creative and stay connected. But one of them is just this kind of thing, to be able to get to talk, talk with people like you and just stay connected to the audience at the club. I do hope a lot of these things will continue after we're all back together again too, but it's been really interesting to watch. Now you guys are going to play for us live, right?
Well, we weren't really planning on it. I got my horn here, but
you want to just play blues and B flat? Okay. How about the medium tempo? A couple choruses. One, two. One, two, three, four.
Thank you so much. That was great. What an honor. Sorry to put you on the spot like that.
Little microphone.
Yeah. No, it sounded just like a record. The perfect. Thanks so much for being with us, you guys. Yeah.
Okay. Well, it was fun. Great to meet you kind of face to face.
Face to face. Right.
See you next time.
All right.
Thank you so much, guys.
Okay.
Bye-bye.
We appreciate it.
When I was single, my living room looked pretty much like a Louis Armstrong museum. I mean, I had everything all over the house and little plaques saying what the items were and individual shelves on the walls for things, so it really was kind of a shrine. And of course, now that I'm married, I've condensed it into this cabinet here. But of course, I've got to give credit to Candace, because not many wives will let their husbands take over their living room with this kind of obsession, I guess. Now, I'm a firm believer that the best way to listen to music from different eras is to listen to it on the equipment it was recorded and mixed to sound best on. So, if I want to listen to 1950s or 1960s Frank Sinatra, I like to listen on my 1960 Grundig Majestic stereo console. But if I want to listen to Louis Armstrong in the 1920s, I like to play it on the Victrola. Here's one of my favorite items. In the year 2000, I was honored to be able to invite Danny Barcelona, who was Louis Armstrong's drummer from 1959 until he died in 1971, on stage for the first time in 20 years. He hadn't played, and he came up on stage with us at a Louis Armstrong celebration we were doing and played Hello Dolly, and it was like playing with the old record. It was incredible. But he also gave me a few things, and one of them was this letter that Louis Armstrong had written to him in 1968. My favorite line here now, this is written when Louis was in the hospital, and my favorite line here is, he said, "My doctor put me upside down and ran the long piece of iron pipe all the way down my behind, and man, you could hear me screaming for 5 miles. This is a concert program from the legendary Cotton Club in Harlem from an evening he performed there with the singer Maxine Sullivan. Below the program is a couple of table beaters. Now, back in those days, I guess they encouraged the audience to play along with the band by beating those sticks on the table. Not something I'd be a fan of, and I'm glad Campus Jacks doesn't institute that policy." Trumpeter Rick Braun is known for his stellar playing and production in the smooth jazz world, but his career covers multiple genres over several decades. He began producing while a student at the Eastman School of Music in the 1970s, and in the 1980s, co-wrote the hit song Here With Me for superband REO Speedwagon. He also toured the world with artists like Natalie Cole, Glenn Frey, Tom Petty, Sade, Tina Turner, and Rod Stewart. His solo career took off in the 1990s, and he has released multiple hit albums, earned a worldwide audience, and won several awards, including the Gavin Report's Artist of the Year twice.
Look who's with us, Terence.
I hey, know, guys. Ron, man. What's up?
Just hanging out in the studio and having a little a moment with you guys. I appreciate you having me on the show, and very cool. Thank you.
You've been staying busy?
I've been staying busy. I've been working on some two tracks for Dave Cause. I'm producing some tracks for him. So I'm just talked with him, and I'm going to be producing Richard Elliott's new record.
Oh, cool.
So I'm getting ready to do that. And so I've got it's there's a lot of challenges involved with doing music now.
Right.
You know, everybody sends bits and pieces, and you have to make sense of it from a distance and trying to communicate. As a producer trying to communicate simple ideas, it's not as simple as it would be if I said, hey, let's get together and sit here and do this. It's great to still be on the planet, and it's great to be relevant in some way and have people want to hear what we have to say. You know, it's a gift. It's a gift.
Right. Well, speaking of what you have to say, we like to impose on our guests to play a song or two. You up for that? I mean,
I would love to do that.
I see you've got a flugelhorn with you, so.
That's right.
I do. I have my flugelhorn, and the valves are still able to go up and down, which is good.
And beautiful. So what are you going to do for us?
I think I'm going to play us. It's funny because last night my wife and I watched The Summer of 42.
Mm.
And I didn't realize that movie came out in 1971.
Yep.
Of course, Michel Legrand wrote that beautiful theme and wrote the score to that movie. And I'm a big Michel Legrand fan, so I'd like to play one of his songs that I love so much. It's What Are You Doing With the Rest of Your Life?
Beautiful.
Thank you.
Wow, that was beautiful. And you know, and you were talking about that at, you know, your age and all that stuff. And it was also very pertinent in my life at that time, because I was around there. I was adolescent. I had my eyes on that girl, that older girl or lady, whoever it was. It was probably a teacher or something, you know. And I never had the relationship, but I certainly fell in love with a few of them.
I did too. And I had a chance to see Michel Legrand play with he performed with the Philadelphia Orchestra at Robin Hood Dell outside of Philadelphia. And I remember I took my eighth or ninth grade sweetheart to my parents dropped me off and we watched that concert. It was a beautiful summer night. And so, you know, his music has touched me a very early age,
Beautiful. Well, you got another one for us?
You know, I could try a little bit of Have You Met Miss Jones. I'm playing along with this app, and I don't know if any of the young players out there are aware of this app, but it's an absolutely awesome teaching tool. It's called iReel Pro. You probably have it, right, Tony?
Yeah. It's great.
Have you talked about it with the viewers at all?
No, not yet. No, actually, please go ahead.
Well, it's a great app. I think you have to pay something, but it's not much, but it basically has just about every jazz standard, including Christmas songs, if you want to go that way, on it. And you can select tempo, you can select key, you can select, you know, different instruments,
different styles,
the drums,
different styles.
Different styles.
Interesting.
Especially during this quarantine, it's been something I've been using a lot just to be practicing at home, because you really can pull up just about any song. And there's a lot of great play-alongs available on YouTube, or like you can get all the Abersol still. But this one is really easy to use. And, you know, yeah, that's awesome.
Yeah.
Tony, speaking of Abersol, you know, when I was in school, it was even before Jamie Abersol, you know, and then when it did come out, it was like records and these big.
Right.
Oh, it was E flat or B flat, you know, that's all it was for me.
And all your stuff was in black and white.
That's right. Yeah. TV. So was our TV. We didn't have color TV.
Yeah, there's like four channels, you know.
Yep.
Yeah.
All right, let's let Rick play another one.
Have you met Miss Jones? Someone said as we shook hands, she was just Miss Jones to me. Then I said, Miss Jones, you're a girl who understands that I'm a guy who must be free. And all at once, I'm out of breath. All at once, I'm scared to death. All at once, I see the earth and sky. Now I've met Miss Jones, and we'll keep on meeting till we die. Miss Jones and I. Thank you. and Miss Jones. Someone said as we shook hands, she was just Miss Jones to me, to me. Then I said, Miss Jones, you're a gal who understands. I'm a guy that must be free, got to be free. All at once I'm out of breath, all at once I'm scared to death, all at once I see the earth and sky. Now I've met Miss Jones, and we'll keep on meeting till we die, Miss Jones and I.
Fantastic. Wow, that was great.
All right, Rick, so you told us that first of all, thank you for doing that, and you mentioned you're working on a couple of new records for Dave Cause and Richard Elliott, both two fantastic sax players, and mm-hmm. So you've been in the business a long time. Like, what's exciting you these days musically, or you know, the way you're producing or writing, or you know, what's got your mojo going these days?
Well, it's interesting because, the thing that continues to inspire me is when I hear other great players take a song that I've been working on, and you know, we all work in MIDI world. You know, that's how right. we compose, and I've got my computer here and my sequencer and all of that stuff, and so we compose in that world, and then as with Dave's tracks, it started out with having John Robinson play drums on one mm-hmm. of the tracks. Then a very talented drummer, Kahari Parker, played remotely in Chicago on another track, two very different tracks. The one that JR played on is kind of a shuffle. It's a 12/8 thing. And I didn't realize that JR had played on The Way You Make Me Feel with Michael Jackson. And, mm-hmm. and so this right. song has a similar feel. And he said, well, I did this hi-hat thing. And, you know, I overdubbed a hi-hat, and that's how Quincy got that whole sound. And, you know, he did that, and he said, I'm gonna do that for you. I'm going to do that. And so, you know, I take my MIDI drums out, and the song becomes a whole other thing. Right, and then right. then Nathan East comes and plays on it. He didn't come here, but he played on it. And you get Nathan's part, and you think what was a perfectly fine MIDI bass part that you fell in love with, right. all of a sudden falls out of, it's like, forget about that shit.
right.
Now you got Nathan East on there.
Yeah.
And then I'm very fortunate to have David Sanborn played on this track wow. with Dave.
Oh, wow.
And it's like, I've had a chance, and I've known David for many years, and you know, he's a great guy, and just getting reacquainted with him, and he's at his house in New York. And of course he's got to be very careful because he's had health issues through his whole life, but mm-hmm. having his voice on the track, and then of course Dave's voice on the track, Philippe Sais is playing. So the long story short is this, and I'm not doing this to drop names. I'm saying it because what inspires me most and what gives music longevity to me is the voices of all of who's playing on it. You know, mm-hmm. the voices of all of these players adding their years of talent, their immense talent to a track and making it come to life and explode in front of your face. And it's just all of a sudden it's like, oh my gosh, this thing got bigger and bigger.
Right.
And each thing that's been added makes it more and more wonderful.
So
I'm so blessed to be able to work with people like this. It's absolutely a miracle.
Yeah. Well, Rick, thanks so much for doing this with us and hanging out with us. And it's good to see you again, and appreciate you being here. And
what a pleasure and an honor, my friend. It's great. Thank you so much.
My pleasure.
Round two, as Eclectic American Roots explores jazz trumpet and the far-reaching influence of Louis Armstrong. Louis Prima was a man who owed a huge debt to Armstrong's style. He took that style and mixed it with the Italian music that he grew up listening to, the pop music of the day, and later a Las Vegas-flavored brand of rock and roll. Always the entertainer. Prima didn't always get his due as a musician, but that didn't stop him from becoming one of the most popular artists of the last century. Ladies and gentlemen, here he is from 1936 in the film Swing It, Louis Prima.
Thank you. brings the manuscript that features our four favorite trumpet players, Clark Terry on this end, Ray Nance on that end, Shorty Baker, and the cat, who in his Spanish mode is known as the El Gato, Señor El Gato. Baker, Ray Nance, El Gato.
Four, count them, four trumpeteers. The great Duke Ellington with his man Cat Anderson, featuring Shorty Baker, Ray Nance, and Clark Terry from a 1958 Italian TV presentation. Yeah, trumpets galore. And now let's go on to an excerpt from what I feel is one of the greatest short films ever committed to celluloid. It's the best players of the day, shot in such a beautiful way. It's really a crime that I've had to trim it down for this presentation. And I urge you to go seek it out in its full length. It's not that long, but a little too long for this segment. Harry Sweets Edison, Jammin' the Blues. Dig it.
Just blew in, Little Jazz himself, my man, Roy Eldridge. Driving, biting, and swinging playing is making the temperature rise here a bit. Thank you.
Oh, Lord. Now, that's just good. That's a clip from a 1959 TV show pilot that was never picked up and never aired, featuring the exciting Roy Eldridge, along with Coleman Hawkins, Milt Hinton, Cozy Cole, some fantastic players there. Again, check out the full clip. There's some other great stuff as part of that TV show pilot. Okay, I'm going to take a little break, gather my last little volley of video clips, and I'll be right back, all right? Don't go away. Thanks.
Now from the land where blues were born comes a man and a horn. That's him I'm shouting about. He's swinging out that man with the horn. The man with the horn.
No one to talk with, all by myself. No one to walk with, I'm happy on the shelf. Aimless for heaven, save my love. Oh, baby, this is the end. No forsaking the one I love. And through it plaining, you that I'm thinking of. Aimless for heaven, save my love. Like Jack Horner in a corner, don't go nowhere, and I don't care. All your kisses are worth waiting for, believe me. I don't stay out late, leave Jen alone. I'm home about it, just me and my gramophone. Ain't Missy Evan said I love you.
Considered one of the most important and improvisational figures in jazz, Louis Armstrong almost single-handedly taught the world how to swing. Armstrong was an American trumpeter, composer, vocalist, and actor whose career spanned five decades, from the 1920s to the 1960s, overlapping different eras in the long history of jazz. Finally known as Satchmo, which was short for Satchel Mouth, referring to his large lips, Armstrong was born in 1901 and grew up dirt poor in a single-parent household in New Orleans, the city that sowed the seeds of jazz. But jazz were not the only seeds being sown in the red light district where he was born. His neighborhood was the infamous Storyville, a section of town that was filled with legal houses of prostitution, honky-tonks, and opium dens, until World War I put a stop to it. Without those bars, clubs, and brothels of early New Orleans, blues and jazz might never have achieved the economic base which allowed them to so spectacularly cross over into the mainstream. By the time he was seven, Louis Armstrong was looking for work wherever he could find it. He sold newspapers and made a little money singing on street corners. He was 13 when he got in trouble for firing a gun on New Year's Day and was sent to the Colored Waifs Home for Boys, a juvenile detention center in New Orleans. There he learned to play the bugle and the cornet, soon becoming the leader of the home's brass band. They played at socials, picnics, and funerals throughout New Orleans. In a short amount of time, Louis began to make a name for himself around town, capturing the attention of many of New Orleans' premier musicians, including one of the city's best-known trumpeters, Bunk Johnson, who befriended the young Lewis. The famous early jazz star, Joe King Oliver, became a mentor and teacher to Armstrong. King Oliver's colleague, the great trombonist Kid Oree, would eventually hire the 18-year-old Armstrong to play on the Mississippi River boats for over three seasons. 4 years later, in 1922, Armstrong followed his mentor, King Oliver, to Chicago, where he played second cornet in the dynamic Creole Jazz Band. He made his first recordings with that band in 1923. In Chicago, Lewis met pianist Little Hardeen, who would not only become his second wife, but would be instrumental in convincing Lewis to step out from King Oliver's shadow and pursue his proper place as a frontman. As a soloist, the young Armstrong would soon become a foundational influence in jazz and American popular music, shifting the focus of the music from collective improvisation to solo performances. Satchmo soon relocated to New York in order to join Fletcher Henderson's band. In 1929, Armstrong appeared on Broadway in Hot Chocolates, in which he introduced Fats Waller's Ain't Misbehavin', his first popular song hit.
No one to talk with, all by myself. No one to walk with, I'm happy on the shelf. Ain't misbehavin', save my love.
Armstrong eventually became the prototype of the traveling musician who lived in trains, planes, taxis, hotel rooms, clubs, and recording studios. He made a tour of Europe in 1932 and played at Buckingham Palace on several occasions, first invited by King George V, a noted enthusiast of improvisational music. During one concert, Armstrong famously broke royal protocol when he said to the king, "This one's for you, Rex." When he returned to the States in 1935, Armstrong performed in films, on the radio, and in the best theaters, dance halls, and nightclubs in the world. While his band was performing at the Cotton Club in the 40s, Armstrong met a dancer named Lucille Wilson, and the two were married. It was his fourth and final marriage. In the late 1950s, the U.S. State Department made Armstrong a goodwill ambassador to play American music overseas. He rarely publicly politicized his race, often to the dismay of fellow African Americans, but he did take a well-publicized stand for desegregation during the Little Rock crisis in 1957. And in 1959, he refused to go on a State Department-sponsored concert tour of the Soviet Union because he felt the administration of President Eisenhower wasn't doing enough to promote civil rights legislation. He was one of the first African-American entertainers to cross over, whose skin color was secondary to his music in an America that was severely racially divided. He was able to access the upper echelons of American society at a time when this was more than difficult for any black man. As an actor, Armstrong appeared in films such as High Society in 1956, alongside Bing Crosby, Grace Kelly, and Frank Sinatra. And he took a dramatic turn in A Man Called Adam with Sammy Davis Jr. His fame reached its zenith when his recording of Hello, Dolly! From the musical of the same name, went to number one on the Billboard Hot 100 charts in 1964, knocking the Beatles off the chart, 4 decades after his first recordings were made. In fact, he had even forgotten he'd recorded Hello, Dolly! Until audiences started demanding it on tour. While in the Midwest, he had to wire back to New York for his manager to send a copy of the record so the band could relearn it on the road. Hello Dolly won the Grammy for Song of the Year in 1965, and Armstrong received a Grammy for Best Vocal Performance, Male. Armstrong also performed the song with Barbara Streisand in the popular 1969 film version, Hello Dolly.
Well, hello.
Look who's here.
Dolly. This is Louis.
Hello, Louis.
Dolly. It's so nice to have you back where you belong.
I'm so glad to be back.
Are you looking swell?
Thank you, Louis.
Dolly, I can tell.
Does it show?
Dolly, you still glowing, you still growing, you still
going strong.
I feel the room
sweet.
And the band one of our favorite songs.
Remembering
sound.
It was my favorite.
Show some snap, fellas. Find an empty love. Darling, never go away again.
Satchmo's Hello Dolly was inducted into the Grammy Hall of Fame in 2001. Armstrong also sang one of the 007 theme songs, We Have All the Time in the World, in the James Bond film On Her Majesty's Secret Service in 1969. Louis Armstrong scored yet another hit nearly two decades after his passing when his recording of What a Wonderful World became a worldwide smash, an instant classic, when it was used in the Robin Williams film Good Morning Vietnam. Satchmo has 11 songs in the Grammy Hall of Fame, plus a Grammy Lifetime Achievement Award. In 2017, he was inducted into the Rhythm and Blues Hall of Fame, followed by 2019 when he was inducted into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame, on the strength of his influential 1925 recordings by his first band, The Hot Five. In the last year of his life, Satchmo traveled to London twice, appeared on more than a dozen television shows, and celebrated his 70th birthday at the Newport Jazz Festival. Louis Daniel Armstrong passed away in 1971. Embittered by the treatment of blacks in his hometown of New Orleans, he chose to be buried in New York City. Satchmo was once asked, "What is jazz?" He answered, "Man, if you have to ask, you'll never know."
Bright, blessed days, dark, sacred nights, and I think to myself, what a wonderful world.
Ricky Riccardi is the director of research collections for the Louis Armstrong House Museum and the author of the book, What a Wonderful World, The Magic of Louis Armstrong's Later Years. Ricky lectures on Armstrong at venues around the world, including the Institute of Jazz Studies, the Satchmo Summerfest in New Orleans, the Bristol International Jazz and Blues Festival in England, and the Monterey Jazz Festival in California, as well as teaching the Music of Louis Armstrong graduate course at Queens College, and hosting various listening parties for jazz at Lincoln Center. He has recently co-produced Universal Music's Satchmo at Symphony Hall's 65th Anniversary, The Complete Concert, and Mosaic Records' recordings of Louis Armstrong and the All-Stars. Simply put, there is no one more knowledgeable or passionate about keeping the legacy of Louis Armstrong alive and in the public eye. Please welcome Ricky Riccardi.
Tony, let's welcome your friend here.
Are we live? Oh, I didn't hear the...
You're live, my friend.
Your live direction. Ricky, how are you, man?
Great, man. How are you?
I'm good. It's good to see you.
Yeah. Yes, sir.
It's great to meet you too, Ricky.
I haven't seen you face to face for 3.5 years now. When I was
been
there.
A while.
We were there with Jane at the house. So I'm gonna just say this, for those of you who watched or know me at all and know that I'm obviously an avid Louis Armstrong fan and have collected Armstrong memorabilia to the best of my meager ability. Once I found out about the house being open in New York and the archives and all that, I started checking out. I just knew I had to get there. And then finally one day I got there and I had already stalked this guy online because I wanted to meet him, and he gave me a tour. It was just the greatest experience. And if you ever get to New York, and I think I've said this before, but don't don't go to New York without going to see the archive or see the House Museum. Even if you're not as the biggest Louis Armstrong fan, it's just one of the greatest experiences and so moving and interesting. And I've sent people there who didn't really have much of a desire to go, and they just thank me profusely. And so much of that is due to this man right here, who just is the biggest, most knowledgeable guy on Louis Armstrong these days. And yeah, it's just so great. And he's so enthusiastic. I love everything you post.
Man, so. I don't know how to respond, but right back at you.
Well,
he's taken your legacy and brought it to the West Coast, you know.
Oh, barely. listen, one thing I would like to have you do, Ricky, I didn't mention this to you, but I would love for you to tell the story of how you got that job, because you're not really a qualified, so we speak, a qualified archivist, right?
Like, no, God, no.
Okay, let's hear that. It's such a great story.
I might get fired at the end of the day. the short version is I went to Rutgers. I got a bachelor's in journalism. I got a master's in jazz history and research, which, you, as you can imagine, is a burgeoning field.
Right. You were after the money, weren't you?
I took my master's degree and I painted houses for the next 4 years, which is true. But during that time, I started my Armstrong blog. I began giving lectures. I began kind of making a reputation, and I began doing research at the Louis Armstrong Archives at Queens College. And one day I saw they were hiring a project archivist to arrange, preserve, and catalog the Jack Bradley collection. I didn't know how to arrange, preserve, or catalog, but I knew Jack Bradley.
So people know, Jack was a friend of Louis and a photographer who captured a lot of his later years, right?
He was personal photographer, best friend. He was his marijuana dealer. He did it all.
Now you're fired.
Yeah, I'm going out with a blaze of glory. So finally, I applied for this job, and Michael Cogswell, it's actually kind of poignant. He passed away last week. He was really my mentor. He was the guy who built the whole place. Yeah. He did an interview with me, and the first half of the interview were all Armstrong questions, which was a breeze. The second half was all library questions, archival questions, and I didn't know. I was like Ralph Cramden up there. But they brought me in for an in-person interview, and they showed me. They picked a random box of Jack Bradley photos, and they said, this is what you're going to be working with. And Michael held up a contact sheet, and I took one look at it. I said, oh, that's a Mercury recording session from the fall of 1964. And there was no words on it. So they looked at it, and they said, how do you know that? Well, I said, that's Big Chief Moore on trombone and Eddie Shue on clarinet. And that addition to the band was only together for a certain amount of time. They only made 2 recording sessions. And about 90 minutes later, I got the job.
That is right, so great. The
right answer.
And they're just, I don't know that there's anybody else in the world who could do that at the level you do it at. It's so great.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's the only thing I'm qualified for. So I've been very, lucky to me. If you would have told me, you know, I first discovered Armstrong's music when I was 15. And so if you would have told me, 25 years later, I'd be making a living doing this, I never would have believed it. So
yeah,
I don't take anything for granted.
And again, because a lot of people who are watching this will not be familiar with it. Louis' house is a very, very simple little house in Corona, Queens. And I'll let you tell the story, but how his wife bought it. And yet, even though he could have lived almost anywhere and been in a big mansion, he chose to stay in this little place. And
indeed. I mean, Armstrong, you know, he leaves New Orleans in 1922, and then he spends most of his time in Chicago and New York, living out of apartments, living out of hotels. He gets married for the 4th time to a cotton club dancer, Lucille Wilson, in October 42. He was living at a Hotel Olga in Harlem at the time. Their honeymoon was 6 straight months of one-nighters. And Lucille said, this is not what I signed up for. So she was the one. She actually spent part of her childhood in Corona. She was still friendly with some of the families on the block, found out that the home was for sale at 3456 107th Street, went, put down the down payment, never told Louis, moved in, moved her mother in. And then Louis, he was on tour for about 6 months. And finally, the tour was about to end. And she told him, listen, when you come home, we have a home now in Queens. And so at first he hit the roof. And yeah, because the last thing he wanted was a home. But then he took one look at it, and the cab driver pulled up, and Louis told the cab, he said, oh, man, quit kidding. Take me to the address, I'm supposed to be at. because, you know, when you drive past it, it looks like your typical Queens Archie Bunker kind of house. And, you know, here is this, you know, jazz's greatest genius, but he had never had anything like that before. And so it, to him, he took one look at it and it was too big, too lavish. You know, what was he going to do with that? But once he saw the inside, once he met the neighbors, he saw the whole neighborhood, all the kids on the block, an integrated block. That was it. I mean, as much money, fame as he had, you know, meeting with the Pope and stopping civil wars and appearing in, you know, hit movies and knocking the Beatles off the charts, he always went home to this working class neighborhood and just remained a regular guy till the very end.
Yeah. Yeah. Boy, and I love how the house is preserved. I mean, that kitchen is so amazing. I'm constantly showing pictures of his kitchen. But I also love how, you know, Armstrong would he loved his reel-to-reel tape recorder and recorded conversations. And the way the house is set up, where you walk through the house and you hear recordings of him talking, sitting at that table talking, it's such a moving
that's
experience.
Great.
Yeah.
That's great.
It's so
yeah, I mean, we always tell people that this was kind of his plan and Lucille's plan too. Because after Louis passed away in 71, Lucille gave an interview. You know, I didn't find it till about 3 or 4 years ago, in which she said, "My plan is to leave the house to the city of New York, and that way people could always see how Louis lived." And so I think she would be happy with the direction we went. Yeah. And so with the tapes, I mean, we have about 750 of these reel-to-reel tapes, and on multiple tapes, Louis says he was doing this for posterity. Yeah. So he wanted these tapes to be heard. He wanted it
so
to
great.
Be in control of his own story.
Yeah. And one of the greatest thrills of my life was when you let me play Louis's horns at the archives at Queens College. Like, what a – I remember – and you can see it on YouTube because I put a little video together. Just, I think, look for Tony Guerrero plays Louis Armstrong's horns. And I remember, and I can hear it when I listen to that, I was so nervous. The first note I blew, like, it's just like the shaky little sound. Man, those horns were just so beautiful and so great, so great to play. And what a, I just something I'll never get over. And,
I don't believe I've ever seen you nervous, Tony.
Oh my gosh, I'm nervous all the time. So now, Ricky is also an author, and you're just finishing up your second book. Is that correct? Because I read your first one, which is great. What a Wonderful World. Yeah.
Yeah. So the first one is just about, it's weird the way I'm doing this. This is never what I set out to do. But my first book, What a Wonderful World, is about the last 25 years of Louis Armstrong's life. He formed a small group, the All-Stars. He broke up his big band. And I take it from that period until his passing in 1971. That was always kind of my goal. I finished that book and I said, well, I'm done now. You know,
right. That era hadn't been covered nearly as much as all of his early stuff. Right.
That was the goal. And then I started going out in the field, talking to musicians, talking to students. And I realized that the big band years were just as neglected. You know, if Louis is taught in jazz education programs, it's up to 1928, and everything he did afterwards is pretty much brushed under the carpet. So I decided to write a prequel, and so this next book is going to be called Heart Full of Rhythm, The Big Band Years of Louis Armstrong. It's going to be out in Oxford University Press, fingers crossed, August or so. I just submitted final edits this week, so we are ready to roll. But yeah, this picks up the story in 1929 when Louis comes to New York and pretty much becomes a star and takes it till the end of the big band era and the beginning of the All-Stars. So actually both books will kind of flow together seamlessly. And I'm already getting pressure to finish the job and make it a trilogy and do 1908, 1928, but one step at a time.
Right.
So Ricky, for the uninitiated or the not the fanboy like Tony is, how could somebody get a hold of seeing what you're doing, purchase your books, and see online your presence or whatever?
A little
bit of information.
Yeah, there's some great stuff going on right now that they're presenting online for people like stuck in quarantine. What a great thing you're doing. Tell us.
Yeah, this actually kind of came about. It's the craziest thing because about 4 years ago at the archives, we got a $2.7 million grant from Robert F. Smith, Fund to Foundation, to digitize the entire collection. So everything's digitized.
And you got my $1 million grant, too. Right?
We got it. Yeah, the check, okay. Yeah, it didn't clear, but we got it. So the pandemic hits, the house museum closes, the archives close, Queens College closes. What do we do? You know, I'll admit this, you know, it's a very small staff. We all thought, well, that's the end of us. But my co Sarah Rose, she's the archivist there. She had the idea maybe we should do a virtual exhibit. And our acting director, a guy named Jeff Rosenstock, he had the idea because, well, everybody's stuck at home. We have a house museum. We have all of the fruits of Lewis's labors, all of his hobbies. Why don't we make the exhibit about Lewis at home? And that's all I needed. And so we have now done about 5 or 6 major posts. Every Monday we go with a big content heavy post using these digitized archives. I have access to everything. And so we're telling curated stories of how did Lewis warm up? What's in his record collection? What was his fascination with collages? One going up tomorrow about the neighbors and the actual neighborhood. One next week coming up on race, one on Lucille. And so me and the whole little staff of 4 or 5 of us, we're putting our heads together, editing audio, editing videos, putting together photos, the whole thing. And so that is probably the best thing you can do, because it's the kind of thing, you know, if I had to choose, I would not want a pandemic. I would rather be right now. But you know, it's the ultimate definition of making, you know, lemonade from lemons, because here we are, we're telling these stories and putting together these virtual exhibits, something that we were all way too busy to do. So you can check that out at virtualexhibits.lewisarmstronghouse.org, and the name of the exhibit is That's My Home. And so once you're there, you can hear the audio and see photos and the whole thing, and it's really exciting. So that's the best way to check up on what's going on now. I do my blog, which I started back in my house painting days, is still going. That's at Dipper Mouth, which is one of Lewis's nicknames, dippermouth.blogspot.com. And cool. I finished a series earlier this year of covering every single that Lewis made between 1929 and 1934. It's about, I don't know, 70 posts or something like that, but that's all up there. And then the books are all on Amazon. I'm on Facebook. I'm easy to find. And I'm pretty much all Armstrong all the time. So between the blog and the archives work and CDs, I have a box set coming out. Mosaic Records will be out this fall. All Lewis's Columbia and RCA stuff from the 50s and 60s. I don't know. I'm the luckiest guy in the world. So just find me if you love Lewis Armstrong, and good things will happen.
Right on. Well, man, thank you so much for being here with us. And I'm just... I love everything that you do. I'm so grateful for the work you do, and I'm glad that I get to just kind of expose that to some people watching, and hopefully they'll go check it out too. And Terence, you should really learn who Louis Armstrong is.
Yes, I am. I was going to say, you know, we really appreciate it. You know, I'm a sax guy. I gotta go over into that other kind of brass instrument. But, you know, Ricky, really nice meeting you. Really appreciate you coming here. And in parting, I wanted to ask Tony something, though. Is there anything on Ricky's wall that you would like to take? Or
you know, if he were sitting in the Armstrong house, I would say absolutely.
Tony has this thing about finding things on people's walls here that he sees, and he does this manipulation to somehow get it. So,
yeah, it hasn't worked once, but
what a pleasure, well, Ricky.
Yeah, till next time. Thank you, guys.
Take care. Thanks, Rick.
Thank you.
As a trumpet player, you can't really escape being influenced by Louis Armstrong. But every instrumentalist that followed Louis Armstrong was influenced by his approach to jazz, to swing, and melodies, and improvisation. As a singer, he was one of the greatest singers of all time as well, and influenced everybody from Billie Holiday to Tony Bennett to Frank Sinatra, Ella Fitzgerald. Even singers today are a product of some of the advances he made in how to phrase, how to approach a lyric and a melody. And so there's really no denying his influence on how we play music. But even culturally, his music, he had hit records from the 1920s, the 1930s, the 40s, 50s, the 60s, when he knocked the Beatles off the charts with Hello Dolly. And then again in the 1980s, almost 20 years after his death, when Good Morning Vietnam, the movie, came out, and his song What a Wonderful World became a worldwide smash. So as an artist, he's one of the most important artists of the 20th century, and his influence is still felt today. I have quite a few concert programs, some of them signed, some not, and these are just from different concerts he did over the years. My personal favorite is this one right here. This program is signed by several members of Louis' band at the time, Cozy Cole, Velma Middleton, Arvel Shaw, But the signature that really got me excited about this particular program is the one right under his face there, because it says Clarence Armstrong. Now, the guy I bought it from thought that Lewis must have been goofing around and just wrote Clarence instead of his own name. But a lot of people don't know that Lewis Armstrong, while he didn't have children of his own, he did adopt a boy named Clarence, and he took care of him his whole life. Clarence had some mental disabilities and needed a lot of help, and Lewis was there for him his whole life. Well, this signature is actually Clarence Armstrong's signature, and I've never seen another one, so I'm very excited to have it. Arturo Sandoval is a 10-time Grammy-winning trumpeter and composer. His virtuosic playing has earned him a worldwide following and his place in line among the greatest trumpet players of all time. He has performed globally, including appearances at the White House, the Super Bowl, and all the major award shows. Sandoval fled communist Cuba, defecting while on tour with his mentor, Dizzy Gillespie, in 1990. And in 1998, he became a U.S. citizen. In 2000, his life was turned into an HBO movie called For Love or Country, The Arturo Sandoval Story, starring Andy Garcia. And he's gone on to compose music for several films himself, working most recently with director Clint Eastwood. In 2013, President Barack Obama awarded Arturo Sandoval the Presidential Medal of Freedom. Please join us in welcoming Arturo Sandoval to our Steamer's Jazz at JAX show.
Arturo, welcome back to the show.
Yay, Arturo. Man. Hey, Tony, I got only one question. When are you going to come back to work, man? I miss you so much.
We're gonna make that happen this week again.
Hey, man, so, please.
Yeah, so I'll tell everybody that in the last several weeks, I've gotten the opportunity to work with Arturo on several of his projects and just different projects, even some of my music and films he's been scoring. And it's just been a real pleasure to get to work with you and to get to know you better. And that's what we've been able to do. So we'll hopefully try to make that happen again this week.
Hopefully. Yeah. We're behind the schedule.
Yeah. Arturo, one of the things that we wanted to talk about tonight was, this song of yours, which I'm not going to pronounce it very well, but La Corona de la Primavera. Was I close?
La Corona de la Primavera, which is the crown of spring, of the spring.
So I'll just tell the story, but several weeks ago, Arturo posted on Facebook just a short little video of himself improvising this melody. And then I heard it and I listened to it a couple times and I just thought it was so pretty and it implied certain harmonies to me. And so I sat down at the piano and then I harmonized it. And then I recorded my piano to his video and I sent that to him. And then we started talking about that. And then I did a totally different version. We're going to talk about all these. But then we sent it to my friend Bob Barrett and he did a big orchestrated version. And we just thought it would be fun to show the audience the evolution of a song like that and how it can grow and turn into something, you know, bigger than it started even.
But before you do that, I would like to say that the day you sent me the piano company that you did with the choral things, that was a lucky, very lucky day for me, because that's the day I discovered the sweetheart of Tony Guerrero. And then I said, no, I'm this is no bullshit. I'm speaking from my heart. And I told him that day, he's a witness, you know, I said, Tony, from now on, we are brothers. And you just get my heart, man. And I'm so overwhelmed by such a beautiful tribute that you just did. With a very simple improvisation, I just, you know, I was doing nothing here, and I said, I went to the living room, I put the phone there, and I just played something, whatever. I don't even know what it was. And then he came out with those chord and thing, and that became a kind of a little piece instead of a little improvisation.
The rest is whatever you want to do with it.
Yeah. Well, it's been my honor, Arturo, the last few weeks to, like I said, to get to know you better and to get to actually work with you. And
then I recorded a couple of your tunes also.
Yes, you did.
The videos they are beautiful tunes, man. Gorgeous tune and great production, great video, great musicians. Man, it's a first class thing. I'm very pleased and grateful that you invite me to join that group of great musicians to do your tunes.
Thank you very much. It means a lot to me. Let's do this. I'm going to ask Tim to roll the very first video, which is your very first improvisation that you posted, and then we'll be back in just a few moments.
Good.
So that was the first video that I saw posted. And like I said, I listened to that a few times, and you know, it just, as he was playing it, I was hearing music behind him because it just implied all these harmonies and swells and this, you know, beautiful structure. And so that's where I sat at the piano. And for those of you who aren't musicians and may not realize this, when you play a single note, you have a lot of options about how to harmonize it and the different chords you can put behind. That
you made the right choice.
Well, I thought your melody dictated certain things, and so let's watch the video now. This is what I sent back to Arturo, so that you'll hear the piano, and that's me playing, but the video is the same one of him. But so we'll watch that.
Pardon for the quality of the sound, especially of the trumpet, because he was recording in the cell phone.
Oh, sure.
Thank you.
That was his improvisation with me harmonizing it on the piano. One of the things we did before we get to the big finale of that is I also like to take songs and maybe explore them in different ways. And, that particular piece, as it stood, had a very, it's basically like a very classical feel in a sense. And I in my mind, I also imagine what it might be like as a bossa nova. So we're just going to show just, 30 seconds or so. I did a version of my own. This is just me playing and me recording this at home, but a totally different take on the same melody. And so I'll ask Tim to run that for a second, just a little bit of it. We don't have to watch the whole thing. My friend Bob Barrett, if he would consider orchestrating this. He's a fantastic orchestral arranger and composer, and I asked him if he would take a look at this melody and orchestrate it. And so this full orchestration that you hear, computerized orchestra, is by my friend, the very talented Bob Barrett. Beautiful, Arturo. I was able to introduce Arturo to Bob and Bob to Arturo, and that was the end result, which is just a beautiful take on that lovely melody. And so thank you, Arturo, for letting me be a part of that.
Fabulous. Thank you, because the whole thing happens because of you.
HBO 20 years ago did a movie on the story of Arturo's life, and it starred Andy Garcia as Arturo, and you can find that movie right now on YouTube. The full-length movie is available on YouTube, so I would invite you to
You
don't have to pay. You just have to send Arturo a check.
Yes. Oh, yeah. or a tip jar.
Right.
Yes. we desperately need a tip jar these days.
That was beautiful.
Okay, guys, I'm gonna leave the room, but I'm gonna keep watching you. Okay.
All right.
Thank you, guys. Thank you so much.
See you. We'll talk soon.
God bless you.
Love you, my friend. Thank you so much.
Keep doing what you're doing, man. Keep doing this.
We really appreciate it. Thank you, sir. Wow.
Doesn't get better than that.
That was, it took my breath away. Unbelievable. And, you know, he was talking about a tip jar, right?
That's right. You can mention the tip jar.
That was
I'll tell you, just since you, the couple of projects we've worked on and watching him sit there as he's scoring a film, he's basically sitting at the piano and improvising. And he's just never runs out of ideas. Just continually coming up with melodies and structures and all that. So it's really great to watch. And
oh my gosh, what an honor. Oh boy.
And I'll tell you what, we're gonna play one more video from Arturo. I found this one recently, and I remember when he did this live. And he has a really great story, and in fact, that movie will tell a lot about his life story. And there's a documentary coming out about his life also. But just being in conversations with him over the last few weeks, I don't know if there's anybody that loves this country more. And he'll even say, nobody loves this country more than me. Maybe they love it the same, but not more. And he got the chance to play the national anthem at the 2012 Orange Bowl. And I just happened to see that video recently. So I thought it'd be fun to just show that here.
Oh, beautiful. Beautiful. So.
No collection would be complete without having some autographs, so I do have a few, and here's just a couple of them on some albums. This one's also signed by Harry James. Another one of my favorites is this 8x10 given to me by Danny Barcelona. So the story goes that Louis Armstrong was a big fan of Swiss Chris, which is a laxative, and he would take it every single day and recommend it to all of his friends. He even gave it to royalty when he visited England. And one year, for his Christmas card, he sent this out as his card, a picture of him sitting on the toilet. This is an 8x10 from that photo shoot. It's not the same one used in the photo, but it's actually one that hadn't been seen before. And I'm very proud to display it. And right over here is a Swiss Chris box that was signed by Louis Armstrong. Well, I hope you enjoyed looking through my stuff here. If you're ever in the neighborhood, feel free to stop on by and see it in person. I'm just not going to give you my address. So now, back to the show.
Big Sandy back again, and it's Miles Davis time. I have something here that you haven't seen before. At least, not like this. Here's the deal. In December of 1957, Miles went into the studio with a quartet of both American and French musicians and cut the soundtrack. They recorded the score for director Louis Malle's film Elevator to the Gallows. They recorded in one overnight session, completely improvised, Miles leading the way and the band following along. And it's a really atmospheric movie score that they laid down. So that's cool. But at the same time, there was also a documentary that was being made of Miles' trip through Europe. And they happened to capture Miles in the studio watching the film on the screen and playing along. So I found that footage and I combined parts of that with that actual scene from the movie that he's recording in that documentary, put them together. So here it is for the first time. Check it out. Hope you dig it. Thank you. back-to-back 2 Miles Davis clips. Old 2 miles. Old 3.2 kilometers in Europe. All right, I had a few requests for this next artist, Chet Baker. Known primarily for his cool jazz, laid-back sounds, but here he is in a particularly hot session from 1964 in Belgium. He's not playing the trumpet here, it's a flugelhorn. But let's see if we can get this one past the sensors here. All right, take it away, Chet. We'll be right back. Good Lord, that just gets it. Two of the all-time greats. Once again, Dizzy Gillespie, that time with the legend of legends, Charlie Parker. Just blowing the roof off the joint. Tearing it up, 1951, Hot House. Just through the roof. And that's it for me. My time is done here. Stay tuned to the end of the show, but I'm going to sign off for now. Thank you for stopping by. Thanks to all the fine guests we had here this afternoon. Thanks to Christopher Burkhardt for having me on board, and thank you for sending your cards and letters. Till we meet again, my friends, I bid you adieu. Bye for now.
That's our show, folks. Thanks for watching, and tune in every Sunday at noon for another adventure in the wide world of roots music. You know, we really appreciate all those great donations you guys are sending our way, and we make sure it gets to the musicians. They're the ones that don't have any gigs anymore. They're the ones that matter. And that's why we put on these shows, Eclectic American Roots, to support our musician friends. For more information on this show and other shows like it, go to Stellar Jaxx channel on YouTube, Stellar Jaxx, J-A-X. If you are interested in live music as well as streaming music, we continue to put on live shows on a regular basis at Campus Jaxx in Newport Beach. For more information on those shows, just go to stellarshows.net.